Nintendo, oh, it's sorry, boy, I think you're really sweet. I'm a super scoring girl with glitches, graphics on my mind. Like a culture code, I'm full of life, I'm never out of time. We can play together, you be playing what I don't play too. As long as it's a good controller and I get to sit with you.
It's about time that I covered a Commodore 64 game, a classic computer with some classic games, like Thomas the Tank Engine and Friends. What, is that not a classic Commodore 64 game? God damn it.
Thomas the Tank Engine, a British kids' classic. Originally appearing in book format in 1946, this adorable fossil fuel guzzler got his own TV show in 1984 on ITV in the UK. Famously, Ringo Starr of the Beatles was the narrator initially, although in 1991 he was replaced with George Carlin. Thomas the Tank Engine is still an active franchise, which obviously made me look up the terms of fair use again, but it does say a lot about the timeless nature of the show. For me though, and for many 80s and 90s kids, it's the older episodes that really encapsulate the true essence of the little blue engine.
The episodes in Thomas the Tank Engine tend to cover some pretty mundane events around the management of a railway. Basically, if the track somewhere's a little bit wonky, then it's all kicking off in Sodor, the land where the series is set.
Thomas is a cheeky but well-meaning train, eager to please and make his deliveries on time.
Six small wheels, a short stumpy funnel, a short stumpy boiler, and a short stumpy dome.
His friend Percy is a bit hyper and irritating, and then there's other trains like this mardy bastard, Gordon, or this utter knobstick Diesel. Look at him. Look at his face. One of the more famous scenes you might have seen floating around on the internet is from this older episode from 1984, in which the train Henry drives into a tunnel and refuses to come out because he doesn't want the rain to ruin his newly done paintwork. So what does his driver and the fat controller, the manager of all the trains in Sodor, do?
"We shall take away your rails," he said, "and leave you here for always and always and always."
Starts to wall the poor bastard up in the tunnel.
"Look, kids, the train is getting buried alive! Haha, what fun!"
And that's the end of it. He just sort of gets left there, indefinitely, rotting away in the dark. What even is the moral of this story? Does anyone know? Something about paint.
"But I think he deserved his punishment. Don't you?"
Bit of a side note, but did you know that the Fat Controller's actual official name is Sir Bertram Topham Hatt? I only just found this out while researching for this video, and I have to tell you, I am absolutely seething about it. What a f***ing stupid name. What pillock parents name their kid after headwear?
That's like my parents putting cat ears on me and then calling me Octavius Kitten. Wait.
Well, anyway, a good kids' TV show will often get a video game, and Enigma variations were the ones to take up that job, releasing the game on the ZX Spectrum and Amstrad CPC in 1990. These games were published by Alternative Software, whose main thing throughout their lifespan was to release budget titles. Here's a ZX Spectrum version of Thomas the Tank Engine and Friends.
Oh! Oh! Oh god!
For some reason, the music for the Spectrum version is equivalent to an electric mixer being shoved down both ears.
No, it's cool. I didn't want my eardrums anyway.
Thankfully, you only get it on the title screen, but that won't make you feel better when you're trying to play the game while suffering from severe tinnitus. To add insult to injury, the box actually says, "Including original theme music." You know, as if that sexual assault of your eardrums is a selling point.
Well, interestingly, after some research, I found that this tune is actually the original tune which they play when you enter the gates of hell. So, technically, it is an original theme music.
Wow, these illustrations really do push home the fact that, fundamentally, the thought of a train with an actual humanoid face is unutterably terrifying. Imagine waiting for the Jubilee line and just an enormous grimacing face comes out of the darkness of the tunnel. I mean, the face of the train, not the tube driver. Now, the Spectrum and Amstrad version are very similar. The title music for the Amstrad one isn't mind-meltingly intense, though. But the Commodore 64 version has a bit more to it and it looks nicer, so we're gonna have a look at this one.
Have I walked into a rave?
Well, of all the title screen changes I was expecting to see in the Commodore 64 version, I think it's safe to say that Percy and Thomas bouncing around at 100 miles per hour, smashing into the sides on each other with big grins on their faces, was pretty low on that old list there.
Why?
Oh, and on the high score screen too. Look at these two. They're like the 30-year-olds that got a bit too drunk at their kid's party and got on the bouncy castle. Stop that. Stop it.
Well, this music is a lot better than what we just heard on the Spectrum. Makes it sound like a bit of a banger, actually. Is it not gonna stop?
Get used to that tune, because you're not gonna stop hearing it go round and round the entire time you're playing this game on the C64, and in your head for days afterwards.
Good job my eardrums are already burst.
Now, the premise of the game is simply that you, as Thomas, need to complete a bunch of jobs for the Fat Controller within a week. They are the same jobs across each version of the game, by the way. Thomas's job list is pretty varied, though. He has to take logs to the sawmill, coal to the power station, oil to the oil refinery, get the mail delivered, deliver a tractor, get medicine to a hospital, and take some kids to the seaside. I'm guessing he's using a temp agency. The journey in each level is very similar, but not entirely the same. Each time you'll start out as just Thomas by himself, and you need to pick up a trailer of whatever it is that you're delivering from a spot around halfway along the track. Your only controls are up, down, left, right. That's it. Obviously, being that you're a train, your movement is pretty limited. You'll have a selection of routes on each screen, and you can reverse too. And rather nippily too. I'm a train! Now, each of these tasks need to be completed in one day. You'll see how much time you have left by looking at where the sun is in the sky in this cute little illustration at the bottom of the screen. These drawings of Thomas, not so cute. Although the ugliest Thomas face definitely goes to the Amstrad CPC version. Look at that nose. Thomas and the rhinoplasty malpractice suit. My favourite episode. Aw, look at this nice game. Thomas is just pootling along, it's a beautiful sunny day, everything is great. Oh god! One of the main reasons you can't just tool along at full speed is that boulders appear at random on the tracks. Every time you hit a boulder, the Fat Controller tells you you need to go back two screens. So basically, instead of continuing to the rail station, go and reverse a couple of miles and then keep going. I'm pretty sure this is how Southern Rail operates. But the location of boulders changes at every screen refresh. If one is in your way, then you just need to switch between this screen and the previous screen continuously, and at some point, it will disappear. Not too sure what happens here. Maybe some rail engineers quickly nip out and pull the boulder off the track so you can keep going right away. In Sodor, railway management is very efficient. Okay, Thomas, boulders aren't hard to avoid if you just give the invisible rail engineers time to do their jobs. Let's just keep going. Oh, God! Watch where you're going, Thomas.
Watch where I'm going? We're on a train track! That means there's only one route! Do you want me to put my indicators on and move to the next lane? Do you want me to just politely derail myself so you can go straight past? How would I even do that? I'm a train! Prick.
Yeah, you'll be quite happily just going about your business only to see this green train, Percy from the show, come zooming along the track, usually directly to you. And the response you'll find yourself having to this is to panic and swear loudly. Sometimes you might be able to reverse quick enough that you go back to the previous screen, at which point Percy just disappears. You might also be able to slip into another track if you think quickly enough, but otherwise, this moron is gonna barrel right into you. What confuses me a bit is that both Percy and this guy, Diesel, are your main things to look out for, because both of them have an uncanny penchant to smash right into you without even applying brakes. Come on guys, what the hell?
However, in the books and TV series, Percy is Thomas's closest friend. It's Diesel that's the enemy, really. He's always getting up to all sorts of melodramatic evil in the show. And yet, when you play a level on this game, it's actually considerably more common for Percy to be the one to show up and smash his terrifying round face into yours.
No, no, I'm pissed off about this. We're on a train track, which probably means that we're supposed to be a one-way system. Why is this guy not paying attention?
Let's ignore the fact that this makes no sense whatsoever for the moment. Now, you can get points by picking up these bouncing bonus point numbers which appear on the tracks, but the further you go on the track, the more points you'll get anyway, in small increments. You will get more points if you move from screen to screen, regardless of whether you have already visited that screen. This means that, if you can really be bothered, you can just go back and forth between two screens and rack those points up. Because of the screens refreshing each time, you might see a new bonus point number appear on the track when you do this too, so it isn't difficult to get a high score. But at what cost? In every level, you must pick up this flatbed carriage to take to your destination. It's always a flatbed, and it's apparently already been filled with whatever it is you need in each one, including the one where you need to take children to the beach.
So, I guess some responsible adult has just filled a flatbed carriage with a load of kids and then just left them in the middle of nowhere. They'll be fine, right? They are gonna go flying when that train picks up speed. Night-night, kids.
They can make their own way to the beach if they aren't smart enough to hold on to something. I've got places to go, come on! You will only beat the game if you do every single one of these tasks in one day each. In easy mode, that's not hugely difficult. The time limit is quite generous, so you can take it easy and ensure that you don't smash into boulders or this idiot.
You just know that after all that hard work, we are gonna be rewarded with a beautiful, inspiring end screen.
Well done, Thomas. You have finished all this week's jobs.
Told you so.
What better way to get kids prepared for the thankless drudgery that is the work week? So this easy mode is a bit stressful, but I was able to complete the game within about 10 minutes altogether. Let's take a look at the only other mode, normal mode. Whoa, this is advertised on the game box. Two whole modes? Yeah, baby, give it to me. Well, the main physical differences, if you like, are the fact that now, in addition to boulders randomly appearing in the road, trees will randomly fall across the tracks. Again, smash into them and you're sent back. The amount of time you have now to complete your journey is also much tighter. Plus, it's now a lot easier to fall off the track. In the easy mode, you could get up to a good speed on corners quite safely, but now, take any corner slightly too nippy and off you go. I'm a train! But now, you're introduced to a whole new level of anxiety. Percy appears even more often now, and he's clearly off his face on something strong because he is really going for it. You'll be carefully going back and forth between screens to get rid of an obstacle, only for him to come tearing out of nowhere and smash you to bits. You'll get out of his way, only for him to choose the exact track you chose to avoid him. You'll pick up speed to try and get past him, only for him to appear on the very next screen in an entirely new place. Said place, coincidentally, being up your arse.
No, seriously, are you suicidal? Don't drag me into this, go call Samaritans. I wish I could help, but I can't, I'm a train.
Oh God, the anxiety, the stress, the anticipation of getting your ass handed to you at every turn. At every new screen, you know you need to get a move on because of the time limit, but go too fast on a corner and you'll go straight off the tracks. So you try to take your time, but if you do that, then this green pillock comes barreling out of nowhere and gets right in your face or on your ass, so you have to speed up. But then if you're going at speed while entering the next screen, you're either gonna take a corner too quick or go smashing into a boulder. F off, Percy. All the while, the day is quickly ending, time is running out. The sun will set on you lying on a train track surrounded by the fragments of your friend, while the day ends with nothing achieved. Another day of your life gone forever. Honestly, I'm not purposely being bad at this for the camera. Truly, I could not make one single delivery after more than half an hour of trying each and every level with normal mode. The gameplay just becomes incredibly cruel.
Let me just try and get some tips from this book here.
So you end up in this state of heightened awareness, always looking out for Percy, always keeping an eye open for boulders and trees, your finger forever hovering over the reverse button, ready for backtracking quicker than the Sun newspaper after a lawsuit. Nothing else exists but you and this game, Thomas and that track. And then you get smashed to bits. And when you fail, the fat controller actually threatens to fire you. You are entirely replaceable to this guy, because trains with faces are apparently abundant in this land and all of them are just lining up to nick your job. But boss, it wasn't my fault. Why aren't you firing this tit-smacked lunatic tearing up and down the tracks while I'm trying to do my job?
Why don't these trains with faces have a union? In fact, I don't think they're even getting paid.
Well, I guess that's all there is to say about this. I suppose the graphics are alright, and if you stuck at it, you'd probably get good enough to beat the normal mode. But you will 100% find yourself screaming at one of your childhood's fondest TV characters to go away. I think "fuck off, Percy" may as well be my catchphrase now. I've been yelling it so much. But he really does need to fuck off.
Playing this game is more traumatic than that time I read that fan fiction about Thomas having sex with one of the female trains. Oh my god, don't put the cylinder cock
for draining water from steam locomotive cylinders
in her axle box.
Axle bearing housing.
You've already tried shoving your coupling rods.
Rods in between pins on wheels.
In her blast pipe.
Pipe discharging exhaust steam from cylinders.
All the way up to the knuckle.
Part of a coupler.
And you don't have a narrow gauge.
Narrow track rail spacing.
This is the most terrifying horror story I've ever read, because there's absolutely no way that we're not gonna need a bus replacement service after all this. Please stop shagging, guys. I just want to get home.
To be fair, trains with faces and apparent human thought must have their urges. You gotta have some downtime. Although, the logistics? Your Commodore magazine in 1990 reckoned this game deserved a score of 85 out of 100. This is generous, in my opinion, especially given that for a game released as late as 1990, it most certainly didn't do any groundbreaking. But maybe if you played it as a kid, you would have given it a high score too, and come away with a deep-seated hate for this idiot.
Well, that was Thomas the Tank Engine's first ever video game. And while it's not horrendously bad, it is easily one of the most frustrating games I have ever played in my life, and that is a lot to say for a kid's game. I mean, how many other kids' games can make you feel incredibly stabby? Anyway, now that's done, I need to get to my new job.
I'm a train! Oh, f*** off, Percy.